Welcome to the Expressions, an event platform where we invite statesmen, leaders, global business people to discuss the real issues facing the economy. And today we have with us a very special guest, Uday Kotak, who's known for his acumen, for his conservative approach, and for his success in surviving many downturns. I think, Uday, you started in the 80s, and probably you have a longer memory of the downturns than most people in government and elsewhere have. So welcome to the show. This is on this platform, we believe fear none, favor none. Joining me is Prabhu Chawla, editorial director, veteran commentator, and an old friend. Welcome to the show, everyone. How does the world look as we lift from the lockdown, Uday? You are an investor, and in your bank and other enterprises, you have global investors. So what's your global perspective of what's happening, and how are global investors looking at India?
Thank you, Shankar and Prabhu, and happy to be with you on this channel. I do believe that what we are seeing is unprecedented times, something which most of us have not seen in our lives. And this is a once in a 100-year event. So the real issue today is we are in a challenge which is a health and a science challenge. And we are trying to deal with it from an economic and a financial lens. And that is where this is unique in its nature. It is not like the global financial crisis, which was a excessive financial leverage issue. Similarly, the past challenges which we have seen have been linked somewhere to the economy. But this is coming out of a completely different place. And we have actually, therefore, at this stage, the whole COVID situation, there is no cure at this stage. And the vaccine seems far away. Secondly, lockdown may have been necessary at a point of time, but getting out of the lockdown is not easy. It is complicated. And the economic costs of the lockdown are exponential. And therefore, in this context, when we look at the world has done what it always needs to do, which is at a situation like this, flood the entire system with huge liquidity. The size of liquidity which has been flooded around the world is much bigger than the global financial crisis. This is like the classic throwing money at the problem, since we don't know a core solution. Therefore, in many ways, people are beginning to ask the question, are the economy and the markets on different planets? And I believe that there is a issue there. The markets seem to be saying that we are looking at longer term. Earnings for 2020-21 may be a washout, but we believe in the medium term there will be a solution. So we are looking at earnings of 22 and 23, which is why the markets have been better. On the other hand, I think the economic reality is a much bigger challenge. And therefore, India is also seeing similar dichotomy in a way between what is the perception of the economy in the short run versus how the markets seem to be responding.
Uday, most people have the view that the data shows India doing better than most countries. Reference to comparable to population size and issues like that. You're in Bombay or Mumbai, and Mumbai and where Prabhu is, Delhi, have been hotspots for quite some time. India is occupying the fourth place. Are you satisfied with the way the governments have dealt with the pandemic? In terms of when we say that economy has to open up, lockdowns have been lifted, the critical thing is how we are containing the spread of the disease. So from your standpoint, have state governments done enough? What more would you like to see done?
Yeah, Shankar, a very relevant question. And in that context, when I took charge as CII president, one of the first things we did is to build a theme for the year. So the theme which we have gone out with is building India for a new world, lives, livelihood, growth. And the first point within the theme, we've got a 10-point agenda within the theme. The first point within the theme is protecting lives and livelihoods. And this is where the challenge is, how do we ensure that we are protecting lives from the virus? At the same time, we are protecting lives from the loss of livelihood and the risk around that. So both of these are causing significant losses to lives. And how do we do an appropriate balancing between two separate forces, virus versus livelihood? And my personal view is, at this point of time, whether it's governments, whether it is each of us as citizens, we must do whatever it takes to handle protection of lives and livelihoods both. And it is a delicate tightrope walking. So that is my view on agenda number one. Agenda number two, which we have put right at the top after that, is the importance of healthcare. And one of the challenges India is facing is, we have the lowest, amongst many countries, the lowest healthcare spend as a percentage of GDP. Our spend is 1.3% of GDP. The US spends 14%. Germany spends 10%. China, which is four times our size, spends 3%. Therefore, India, over the years, and this is for last 30, 40, 50 years, every year felt that it did not have the money to spend for healthcare and always has consistently underspent, and we are at this level. Therefore, our view is medium-term spend on healthcare should be India's number one priority, and this crisis must get us in that direction. And I would consider that as the top priority for the nation above everything else. Is there a problem today? The answer is yes. The underinvestment in healthcare over the years is showing up.
You know, it's a fair point. I mean, you know, the underinvestment in healthcare. But, you know, investments in education, healthcare have suffered for years and decades, at least. In my new book, The Gated Republic, I discuss these segments and how there has been underinvestment. But Prabhu will sort of validate this, that, you know, underinvestment in healthcare is not seen as politically profitable. Worse, it is not electorally damaging either. Do you think, I mean, a pandemic of this size and, you know, economic loss will change the mindset of the politicians and the regimes?
See, Shankar,
I'm going to add there. The question is underinvestment. I understand where you're coming from. Underinvestment by whom? By the public agencies or by the private sector? Because private sector also looks at the health sector as a profit venture. Because what is happening now, you must be seeing slowly every day, how much they charge from every COVID patient, how much extra they charge for a coursing tablet. The question underinvestment in healthcare, now corporate world is talking about it. Dr. Reddy was the first person who started private insurance for Medicare in 1980s at that time. But after that, even the insurance is becoming very expensive, because when you go to the hospital, there are hardly any hospitals except your policy, because your high cost insurance private policies have come. Insurance sector has been open for the private sector, but has not made it competitive or better. But I'm going to a different point of view. You're talking about there's a joint responsibility of the corporate sector as well as the government to come together and take care of both lives and livelihood. My only question, which everybody is talking about it, all big corporates from most of Mumbai, They own about thousands and thousands of acres of land all over the country. There are empty spaces of land, and there are empty spaces of land within the business houses also, factory. Why none of them has come forward? Okay, we set up a 1,000 bed inside our premises and keep them there in the labor. None of the industries have come back. They are really jumping with each other, competing with each other, giving money to the Prime Minister Care Fund, 100 crore by somebody, 50 crore by somebody, if you have somebody. But none of them said, okay, I'm giving my 40 acres of land, this place, set up the hospital there. Why that kind of thing is not coming forward?
You know, Prabhu, the point which you are saying has rings a bell, but here is my point. When we are looking at ultimately the development of India, we need to ensure that, number one, we have a policy framework which is creating the right conduct, behavior, and incentives for getting the outcomes we want. Two, there are some areas where public health requires the state to step in and spend come what may. And the third, and I think that is also an important point, the point which you made, and I am a believer that private sector has to build a lot more trust. And it's a fundamental issue where I believe that we need to really focus on building trust as private sector and as a healthcare provider so that people feel comfortable. That
I will add something else, which I said the other day also. Because government and everybody has done enough to incentivize the corporate sector in terms of fiscal policy, the tax concession from 1991 when the reform process started till today. Corporate sector, they have been on the receiving end of everything benefit which comes there. But even after that, what happens now, you find when the COVID is there, there is some kind of a privatization of happiness and socialization of misery. This is what is happening. That why corporate sector can't correct this perception, which may be right, which may be wrong, because poor people are not getting the Medicare or healthcare at the prices which they can afford.
Yeah, no, I completely agree. It's a combination of right policies combined with building trust. And I would raise the level of healthcare debate to defense spending. You know, we think about defense spending for protecting ourselves against our enemies geographically. Think about the virus. It's a far more dangerous enemy than any external enemy we have faced. Therefore, healthcare and spending towards that, whether it is sanitation, nutrition, hospital facilities, telemedicine, the whole gamut, and I'm looking at the whole space, requires to be raised to a level of defense in terms of our prioritization. And I am a believer that finally, what is good for India will also be good politics. That's my firm belief. And it's a question of time. And my view is we need to look at this in the medium term horizon. Therefore, whether it's politics, whether it is economics, finally, we must get a synergy between both to create what is right for India. India above everything else. That's how I look at the world.
Stepping into the nitty-gritty of the economy, Uday, yesterday the Supreme Court was hearing a petition on whether on the moratorium that people who have bought houses or taken loans for automobiles or companies, you know, the moratorium of 6 months for the loans are there, and whether there will be an interest charge or not. But the larger question really is what happens after the moratorium? And I want to sort of ask you this both as a CII president and somebody who understands the mechanics of the financial sector well. And not many people may know that you started your business at the granular level in bill discounting with the small traders. So you know the small businesses, you know the Khata Vahi system, all those things. Is the financial sector strong enough for savers to trust their money with banks and NBFCs and mutual funds? And is this financial sector strong enough to serve the interests of the small businessmen? You know, the big people like Reliance and all can always find a Zuckerberg to pump equity to, but the medium and small enterprises, they are the ones. So what's your view of what needs to be done in the financial sector? How strong is the financial sector or how weak is it?
No, I think, Shankar, the financial sector is fragile. And it has been for a while. And the COVID is another shock which has come. Therefore, my personal view is that if you take the overall banking sector, say 100 lakh crores is the total loan book of the banking sector. The banking sector capital against that is 11 to 12 lakh crores. Even if there is a 4 to 5% loss ratio which comes because of this, it wipes out 40% of banking sector capital. Therefore, one of the most important things is going to be significant need of capital in the banking sector, which is going to come. And I think we are also at this important juncture where if you look at the different segments of the financial sector, which is public sector banks, private sector banks, NBFCs, we really need to reimagine that how is it that we will get to a world-class financial sector and where there is an ability to manage risks properly. And there has been a widespread challenge across different arms of the financial sector, which we are aware of, including the NBFC sector. But the time has come for us to ask the tough questions and significant introspection as a country, both at, of course, at the media level, practitioners level, regulators level, and the government level, to ask the very difficult questions. What is it that we need to do? And my personal view is we need to really focus on the very fundamental basis of banking. I borrow money from a depositor and I lend money to somebody else. And I leverage myself 10:1. I need to ensure that when I lend money, I have the ability of getting back, or else I will have a challenge paying my depositor. Or I must have enough shock absorption capacity as equity capital to take the shocks. And this is finance 101, something which I learned on my grandfather's lap, the basics of the financial sector. But somewhere in this whole gamut, we have got so much into myriad of what I call as the chakra view of this whole complexity of the financial sector, that we need to get back to basics. Basics is that, if number one, what you said, trust. I think, Prabhu, we talked in the context of the health. First and foremost of all, anybody in the banking or the financial sector has a duty above everything else to have the trust and confidence of the depositor.
Yes. Yeah, the trust is very important, because all everybody interested in the trust. I give you a bank a money because I know I will get it back. But what is happening in the past couple of years, that money has been given to people who don't deserve or who have gone away because of failure of their businesses, or they have misused the money. That the cases are coming across here. But what it looks like, that banking system in India is suffering from a trust deficit because of the, what you call, the cabal of people who know each other. Banks have become me and mine, for that I will lend it to so-and-so, you will lend it to so-and-so, you will lend it to so-and-so, and names are coming out these days. You are inquiring into ILFS banks there. ILFS banks, you are still not come to any conclusion. 1 lakh crore rupees has vanished there. And the people who were running, most of them were retired IAS officers and IFS officers. They had created thousands of companies, and a lot of money from the banks had gone into that. So, and ILFS basically, after getting A++ rating. So there is some kind of a trust deficit in terms of both rating agencies, who are controlled by the friends of the bank owners, or who are controlled by the friends of the IAS bureaucracy. So there is a cabal which runs from Washington to New Delhi or Bombay, who decides who will get what in what form. Is that correct or not?
Prabhu, let's be very clear. The banking sector today is even now 2/3 public sector and 1/3 private sector. Okay? So let's be very clear about the structure of the Indian banking sector. Second point is, back to point one, if I lend money, I must be clear that I'm going to get it back. If I believe, yes, I'm not going to get it back, I do not lend money. That is finance 101. And somewhere we have sort of forgotten this in the very basics of banking. Lend money to get it back with interest. And therefore, in the context of that, my view to Shankar's question on the Supreme Court thing, we are asking, the petition is saying, I, for the moratorium period, waive the interest on the loan. What about the depositor? I would never recommend that because of a moratorium, the depositor's interest should not be paid. But finally, a bank is a converter between borrower and lender.
Uday, I'll ask very, I don't have the statistics, but you as a banker would know better. I would like to know the percentage of loans given to the poor people which has gone bad, and the amount involved of the loans which were given to the people you or banker thought were A++ category people. If they add them up, about 13 lakh crore rupees of NPAs at the moment that has gone up during the last 5 years, it has not gone to the poor men's people or middle, as Shankar was pointing out, it has not gone to middle scale or small scale industry. They have gone to the big people. So trust, where was the trust? You had trust in wrong people. I mean, banking sector, not you alone. I'm talking about the private sector.
The banking sector, of course, there is a very big issue about what has happened, and it's undoubtedly correct. But Prabhu, I would also like to highlight that in the post-COVID era, I do believe the susceptibility of unsecured personal loans is also very high, which is effectively loans given to retail. And that loan book will also be coming under significant pressure in the post-COVID era. And I also wanted to highlight in that context, which was mentioned about MSME. And on MSME, I must say that the government has come out with a very good scheme with a guarantee by the government up to 3 lakh crores, which we as banks can lend. And the government of India has guaranteed that money in case the borrower doesn't pay. So that's a huge protection to the MSME sector. And this 3 lakh crores additional loans will go to MSMEs between now and October.
Yeah, there's no question here, because all of you are talking about this 3 lakh crore rupees. We are talking to the people in the field. You are still giving credit to people on the basis of their rating there. During the COVID, rating of everybody has gone down. Your bankers are still insisting, what is your rating? Zero balance sheet will have no rating. You are giving still money to the people whose rating is better than the people who have lost most. Why this rating scam is going on in this country? Because people are giving loan. Why external people should decide? You know Prabhu Chawla is credit worthy, guys. But still you want somebody, Kira, or somebody certified, okay, Prabhu Chawla has got A plus, play A plus.
Prabhu, there are two fiduciary entities who have come under serious scrutiny in the last many years and across different institutions who have had trouble and who have got into trouble. And the two fiduciary entities are the auditors and the rating agencies. And we have to ask the tough questions about the accountability of these two fiduciaries, basis which, as the Prime Minister has rightly said, it is the auditor's signature on the basis of which we trust that company. Now, if that auditor's signature is a problem, there is an issue. Same thing with rating agencies. If rating agencies' ratings are wrong, there is a problem because people trust that rating. And you're absolutely right. Time has come for going back to fundamentals, beyond ratings, beyond credit.
Corporate sector is still depending on them. All the chartered accountant companies who are under scanner now, they are getting the most of the work even from the government and from the corporate sector even now. Rating agencies, the fear is that rating agencies and chartered accountant agencies are now being controlled by people who are not in favor of India's interest. They are controlled by people who are sitting outside country. They decide who will get what. It's a cabala. There's a coalition of people. What don't you think that these rating agencies who have got foreign domination in terms of ownership, they should be banned for auditing and recommending ratings to our Indian companies? Moody is reducing India's rating. They don't reduce the rating of Japan, which was 280% of their GDP. They don't reduce the rating of US, which deficit is much higher than us. And our deficit goes from 3 to 3.5%. All the rating agents jump from the roof and all of the corporate leaders start shouting against the government.
See, Prabhu, one thing is clear, and I've accepted that as a reality. The world is not a level playing field. And if we are dependent on global funds, which we are, with $250 billion of FPI money, with most borrowers having significant foreign currency debt, these people will have a role, and India is not a reserve currency. So we must accept our reality. But
you must be blackmailed, basically.
But no, but we must get stronger.
Because they have invested in your company, not your company, in the Indian companies. Therefore, they can decide whatever you want to do. You give more rate of interest. You don't allow the government to spend public money, public expenditure. You don't allow them to borrow. Now, what is happening? GST will now borrow money from the public, not the government of India. Because deficit will go up. Somebody is Moody will decide what Indian fiscal policy will be, or whether Modi will decide.
No, I think my view is that, I mean, my view is rating is a view. Therefore, if we are strong, for example, Moody's rating downgrade has not affected India so far. But if you read the rating rationale, and I'm just trying to be pretty objective on this, the rating rationale says that they are concerned about medium-term growth rate of India, not just this year's drop. And therefore, the question, Prabhu, we need to ask ourselves that as a Atmanirbhar Bharat, what is it that we need to do to get stronger as a country? And that is in our hands. We must make ourselves stronger.
That's a good segue to sort of get you into what CII and Uday Kotak, singularly and plurally, want to be done in terms of where we are. You know, there are two questions in how the government plans its expenditure, manages it. So, I always say this, and Lalit Mohan Thapar had a very good explanation for why corporates give 9 out of 10 and 10 out of 10 after every budget, even though privately they are very upset about it. And he pointed to a cupboard behind him and he said, "See that? That's a cupboard and everybody has cupboards." So I always remember that and don't pursue that line of conversation. But I think a genuine assessment of how the government manages finances should be done by transparently and openly by the corporate sector. I mean, in 2014, Arun Jaitley's budget announced for an expenditure management commission. Vimal Jalan was the author of that report. Nobody has heard about that. In 2016, there was a labor reforms code introduced. None of the states picked it up. In 2018, farmers were allowed to form collectives and enterprises. No state followed it up. In 2016, Venkaiah Naidu asked for census towns to be converted into urban centers. No state did it. Now, these are all aspects which affect growth, which affect policies. That is one aspect of it. How India sort of funds its economic growth, you know, and if the 101 of economic management is transparency. So, you know, not paying bills of MSMEs, not paying bills of power producers, not paying subsidies to FCI, and as Prabhu said, now GST borrowing left, right. I mean, you know, aren't these things that come into the conversation of industry chambers, not specifically CII, but all others and the government? Shouldn't it be pointed out that, you know, let's clean up this?
Shankar, here is my view about what we need to do at the current time, which is the COVID time. Number one, we must spend whatever it takes to protect lives and livelihood. That is immediate here and now. And I don't think we should be worried about whatever it takes in that context. However, if I come to the medium term, let me give you an example of the choices I believe we as a country should make. There is going to be significant pressure on many industries. Let's take the airline sector. It is going to go into a tough time. I am a believer that if there is a choice between the government saving airline number 5, when there are 4 airlines who will survive, and it comes to survive or saving airline number 5 versus directing that money into medium-term healthcare and education. My view is we should go out there and put that money in our medium-term objective of healthcare and education and let airline number 5 find its own resolution. The state should not be trying to save airline number 5 over medium-term investment in healthcare and education. And these are the choices which will come in front of us as we are going through this period. This is not the end of it. I will bring 2 other points. Let's take the very dramatic shift which is happening between digital and physical world. The physical world is moving digital. Let's take e-commerce. A lot of people today are now getting their goods on e-commerce. They will be going much less to a mall or a shop. Therefore, what happens to the jobs at the malls and the shops? They will be under pressure. But this is a reality. This is not government of India, you or me. It is a consumer voting on her feet. So if the consumer is making that choice, we should be ready to live with that reality. But there is the other side of the coin. What happens to the future of jobs? And I am a believer that time has come for safety nets and social security. The state has to create. The state has to focus on things like healthcare, education, creation of safety nets, and get out of business, including public sector companies. And the reason why I feel they should get out of public sector companies is because you will need money to focus on the medium term. And very often I hear, oh, the price is too low right now. It will get better at a future date. My advice is, whenever you decide to sell, accept the market price as a reality. Do not try and guess the price for the future or what was in the past. And here, Shankar, what the state has to worry about more is that for state-owned entities, it is not just the equity value higher or lower they'll get. All the debt is de facto the liability of the state. By selling the enterprise, you're getting rid of all that potential debt liability which may come to you in the future. And this is the change we need.
Uday, I'll interrupt you again. Shankar, just a minute. Because this is a very fundamental question. Because whenever something happens to the public sector, which any company goes down, they always talk about dump it. They never talk about any private or enterprise that goes bad to dump it. For example, ILFS. Why ILFS has been saved? To save some people or to save the company? Number two, why Yes Bank has been saved? That money which has gone into Yes Bank and into ILFS, no action has been taken against anybody so far. Most of the people are outside the jail even now. The question, you are adding that inquiry committee, I'm not getting into. Air India, you are referring to indirectly, because there has been always a crime. People are talking about Air India. During the COVID, it is Air India which has come to the rescue of the nation, nobody else. In fact, they were not, I will charge the government for not allowing Air India to lease aircraft and bring much more money. During COVID period, Air India could have made money, profit for 1,000 crore rupees for survival. But nobody looking at it, nobody suggesting it. Why Air India is not using enough planes to bring the people back if they're not allowing the areas? Why is this all, like for example, our own BSNL and MTN are going down, but you are still giving some kind of relaxation to all the private telecom company pay after 20 years. Why can't BSNL do the same thing? Why you guys are always talking about private?
Very good point. Very good point. First, when I said airline number 5, I was not referring to Air India.
You're referring to some airline.
Some airline. Other than Air India, all others are private.
Huh? But there is only the public.
I'm saying do not save airline number 5. Put that money into healthcare and education. So that's my, I'm making distinction 1. Prabhu, distinction 2. Very big distinction between ILFS and Yes Bank. In the case of ILFS, the government of India refused to put any money either from LIC or State Bank of India or from the government of India. They appointed a new board but put in 0 new equity capital. Therefore, in ILFS case, government of India actually took the call that we are ready not to put any money, and whatever is the consequence out of resolution, the creditors will bear the loss. In the case of Yes Bank, a consortium led by State Bank of India, who took 49%, put in new equity capital. Therefore, in the case of Yes Bank,
SBI Bank money is going, this public money, my money, which is going to a scam tainted ILF. Why should they spend it there? Let them spend in the health sector.
No,
open more hospitals.
State Bank and a consortium of private sector banks put in.
Correct. The question is money.
ILFS. In ILFS, no state money came in to bail it out.
You are saying state. I am talking about State Bank of India. That is also state-owned company.
No, but State Bank of India also did not put any new money in ILFS when it went down.
They converted their debt, which was not being recovered. That must have been converted into equity. That is what you are saying.
No, there is no equity left in ILFS.
It is gone there. No, everything has gone. Everything is gone because whosoever money was there, it has gone. That was depositors' money ultimately has gone.
Right.
And nobody hasn't been held accountable so far.
No, but I think there is some serious investigation going on. A few people are also behind the bars in the case of ILFS. So all that is happening.
I know. So you mentioned about need to sort of take the call at a time. And this is Finance 101. And I don't know whether government is sort of updating the knowledge of the bureaucracy on Finance 101. LIC, policyholders' money, was used to bail out IDBI. Because they kept saying that, yes, IDBI should not be sold because we are not getting the perfect price. And nobody in government understands or tries to understand, or probably politically not profitable to understand net present value, which is take the money now and run with it. But all of this is sort of, what I call the BC of Indian economy before Corona. Now, after distancing, AD is a separate story. So, the budget that was passed in February 2020, there is very little meaning in the budget left because you don't know what is the deficit, you don't know what's the borrowing. And why has there been any conversation between the chambers, between you and the government and other people who advise the government as to, isn't it time that you sort of accepted what was what and actually presented a new budget? After all, when a new government comes in, sometimes in June and July, you present a new budget. Isn't it time to sort of accept the new reality and present a new accounting picture?
See, Shankar, the fact of the matter is, even today, the impact of the virus, how much more, how much longer, how will this pandemic play out? Frankly, nobody knows. Is this a next 2-month problem? Will there be a second round? Will there be a need for, hopefully not, but God willing, no. But will there be a need for another lockdown? we don't know. Therefore, what do you estimate and budget in a pandemic which is completely a moving target and a mutating target? Therefore, it's a very dangerous thing. We will have to live on our feet. We'll have to think for the present. We have to manage the fact that our fiscal deficit will be higher. Our estimate is center plus state fiscal deficit, which was done in February, center plus state was 6.5%. We are probably somewhere between 11 to 12% already between lower revenues and the package. And a 5 percentage point difference in fiscal deficit is a loss additionally of 10 lakh crores. India's economy is 200 lakh crores. A 5% additional deficit between center and states is basically the states have lost 10 lakh crores additionally.
How do you raise this money?
Mm-hmm.
Sorry, Prabhu, one second. How do you raise this money? Why is it the government shying of raising money, floating bonds abroad, the resurgence in India? You know, is that it's waiting for something to happen, or is it the shyness of the rating?
On this 10 lakh crores, obviously, there is higher borrowing program which the government has announced for some part of it. And the second part, my view, will be indirectly monetized in terms of the government selling their bonds to the market and RBI doing open market operations to buy those bonds. Therefore, monetization of the deficit will be a part by which this will be financed. So essentially, monetization is a different way of saying printing money.
Mm-hmm.
But why can't they go for monetization? Give the money in the hands of people and they will ultimately create demand. The problem is you're suffering from demand at the moment. And you don't know what kind of demand. Demand will come if you give the money in the hands of the middle class, lower middle class. Because what is happening, because of the reforms, you are still getting more income to the higher income level people. Because 1% of GDP growth went to 69% of that went to 1% of the people. Data you have seen. Yeah. Inequitable distribution of income is not able to create widespread demand in the hands of people. So as a CIA, they should be, I don't know, what are your thinking on this? What are your thoughts on this?
Our view is, in the short run, we must be ready to spend whatever it takes for lives and livelihood. Clearly. In the medium term, spend on healthcare, education and nature. Focus on, if it means expanding fiscal deficit, we should be ready to expand fiscal deficit, but keeping in mind financial stability. You don't want a run on the country. So you don't push it to the level where we get a run on the country. We will have to increase our fiscal deficit, which we should be ready for, but keeping in mind financial stability. I am a believer, and CII is supporting this, that the future of jobs is at risk because of change in the environment. If more people do digital versus physical, many people will lose jobs. There's a whole issue of migrants. All my life, I have been brought up to see migrants coming from rural India to urban India. Yeah. What is it that over the last 30, 40, 50 years, we have offered this migrant coming into a city? Most of them have landed up staying in a slum or a chawl. 500 people for one toilet. And this is not today. This is over the last 40 to 50 years. We took it for granted. He got a job which was a daily wage job. There was no job security. And number three, on top of it, the virus makes it much more risky for that migrant to be staying in a city versus a village. You take these three things combined, and I can understand where the migrant as an Indian citizen has chosen to go back to his village. A very justifiable economic and rational decision. I have a horrible life being in a slum. I have a completely insecure job or no job. And on top of it, my life is at greater risk. So the migrant has voted on his feet. But it is here that when the migrant has gone back, I have in my school books, I have read that India needs balanced regional growth. I have not seen that happen. Is this the time when Shankar Iyer can be in Canada, you can be in Delhi and I can be in Bombay and we can have this conversation? I genuinely believe geography is history. We need to create opportunities for migrants in villages. I will give you an example of one company which has done it outstandingly. It was a gentleman called Mr. Wembu who was in Silicon Valley 4 years ago. He left it, has come to India and set up a software services factory, a software services facility in a small village in Tamil Nadu. He stays there himself. He has got his people. He has created an enterprise which is worth a few billion dollars. And from that village in Tamil Nadu, he's serving the world. Why can't we create many, many more models like this? Why can't we create rural health, rural telemedicine, rural infrastructure, so that create more opportunity for that migrant? And should a business or an industry want that migrant back in the city, let them pay for it, fair value and fair price.
Okay. Uday, I'm very happy to know that how it has shifted corporate thinking from total urban thinking to rural thinking.
I am a believer. I wish it of this country.
Yeah, COVID has given at least that kind of wisdom to the corporate sector. I'm very happy to listen
and
to that.
And I think this agenda which we have laid down, this is included. Rural-urban rebalance.
Correct. That should have been done 20 years ago. But anyway, thank God, because now 56% of your GDP is coming from services sector, who employ only 15% of the labor force. But the question is, the migrant labor which you're talking about now, these are the people who are the real wealth creator of the country. They help all of you to create the wealth, and they were dumped into slums. And all of those for whom they created wealth, they bought more extra Boeing than private jets and bungalows and whatever they happened. And now they saw that is happening, because most of them did not look after them when they were suffering from COVID. So I think it's a good idea that you should go back. Why, instead of calling them back, why don't you create some kind of similar infrastructure back in the rural economy, which you're talking about? India is going to live in villages, not in the urban times now. That labor has realized, because like my domestic labor, which has gone back, they say, we won't come back, because let us go. So this MNREGA and whatnot, digging a pond and doing something else, I would suggest CII should work out. You must be thinking, well, how you are going to create similar facilities, good hospital, good colleges, good IT system, where a person sitting in some village in Bihar can also do a Zoom meeting with you and me. They are sitting there.
Absolutely. But broadband and connectivity is across the country. The India of today is different from India 5 years ago. Therefore, the smallest village has connectivity. And therefore, it is possible for us to create a new vision for India. And I am saying this statement that, of course, while China is the factory of the world, and we must get some of the factories into India, we must definitely try for that. But India can also be the office of the world, the front office and the back office both. And I dream about not only going out and getting the factory piece from China, but more importantly, India being the office front and back. And that is the dream which I would like to have.
That's a more balanced and much more robust economic model for India. And I hope that...
Let me ask one last question, Shankar. Which obviously every journalist asks, so I am following journalists, younger journalists, I am 74 anyway. So I'm asking the same question every journalist asks after the budget. And Shankar pointed out that. About the handling of the COVID in terms of how much mass you will give to the government out of 10.
My view, Prabhu, we are still at relatively early stages. And I am very often, I ask myself the question, should we have had the lockdown or no?
Yes, tell us.
And we have today 8,000 deaths only for the size of our population as of today. I do not know, but my best guess is if we did not have the lockdown, my guess is our death numbers would have been much higher.
In America, for example, there are more deaths. Economic activity has never stopped. I'm looking at America and Brazil and Russia, everybody, what I call them, what is the pandemic promoters or peddlers, PPPs, which you talk about it. We have got the new PPPs in India who are talking about always panic in terms of that. We have got 3,10,000 cases now of a population of 135 crore. Russia, Brazil, America together have got only 95 crore people. And our cases are not even 1/10 of these cases.
Which is a good thing.
If the lockdown has not happened, perhaps economic activity could have 300 cases you had the lockdown. They had 1 lakh did not declare the lockdown. On what basis do you say that would have been more?
I'm saying my guess is it could have been more.
My guess is economic activity would have been better.
That's correct. But what about...
You could have imposed lockdown now when it was required.
My personal view is on 24th March, the lockdown, to get India aware of the size and the magnitude of the problem, was necessary. Now, we can debate whether the lockdown should be as long or not. That's a separate debate. But to start with, it may have been necessary in the context of getting people aware of the reality.
Congress party is saying when we imposed the lockdown when it was not required, 300 cases, and we lifted it when it was required. When it is that correct?
No, my view is, my view is that, you know, we are all learning on our feet. There is no perfect answer. And we don't know how this goes, Prabhu. If we open up the lockdown and social distancing is not mentioned and not maintained and there is massive mingling, who knows? We may be in a bigger issue. So this, the future we do not know. Therefore, I would say in terms of judging how we handle the pandemic, we are still in early days.
We also don't know the past because we don't know the counterfactuals. I mean, whether
we don't know the past, we don't know the present, we can't anticipate the future.
No, on the pandemic, at least we don't know the past because the counterfactuals we don't know.
PPP is the lab of the field day.
But I think the robust model that you suggest, Uday, and I hope CII takes it further and on a more balanced economic model, is certainly what is needed now. And your advice to the government on safeguarding the financial system maybe needs to be stated more assertively, stronger words, because I don't think the message is getting across.
So Shankar, I got many questions, but I'll raise one question which is very interesting. Uday, very interesting question. One Srinivas Babu is asking, on one hand, you say Atmanirbhar Bharat, and on other hand, you say we need foreign fund. Please justify how banks can help revive our economy.
See, my view on Atmanirbhar Bharat is a self-confident, self-reliant India, which is a competitive India and engaged with the world.
That is Modi's slogan of make in India for the rest of the world.
I think if we can make the make in India work, India game work, it's a big win for India. But while we work for that, let us also create the office of the world.
Good one. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Goodbye. Bye-bye. Best of luck.